Student friends, let us continue with topic number first, optical fiber communication. Students, in yesterday's lecture, we covered the meaning of optical fiber. That is, optical fiber is a cylindrical dielectric waveguide that works on the optical frequencies, confines the light radiations and guides along the axis of the optical fiber or parallel to the axis of optical fiber from one end towards the another end. We studied the structure of optical fiber, which includes the core, cladding and various layers over that to protect the core against the environmental protection and also the mechanical strength. These fibers are placed anywhere on the ground, in the earth, in the water, in the sea, it may be in the hanging in the air. So such a fibers are going to be gets connected between transmitter as a light source and detector to communicate the signal in the form of light radiation from one end towards the another end. We also studied the types of fiber. That is a step index fiber, gradient index fiber, and also both are classified into again two types, that is monomode fiber and multimode fiber. Dear students, today we are going to study the next aspect of the optical fiber communication, and that is the detector. Detectors are used at the receiving end, means detectors are going to receive the optical radiations which are coming through the optical fiber due to total internal reflection. They receive the light at the output of optical fiber and convert them into its corresponding electric signal. Thus, we can say detectors are the devices which are connected at the optical fiber in the receiver that converts light radiation into its corresponding equivalent electrical signal. So, some of the detectors used are photomultiplier tubes, pyroelectric detector, photoconductor, phototransistor, and also the photodiodes. Dear students, photomultiplier tube makes use of photocathode and electron multiplier tube enclosed in an evacuated glass tube. In this case, light radiations are allowed to incident on the photocathode. It emits the primary electron. Primary electrons are allowed to incident on the next electrode. It emits the secondary electrons. Secondary electrons are allowed to be incident on the next electrode. It emits a tertiary electron, and so on. Electron multiplication that takes place, electron amplification that takes place, and finally it reaches to the anode. No doubt, here light radiations are detected and even converted into its electric signal. It has a high gain, but it has a very large size and it requires the very large voltage. Hence, it is not compatible for the optical fiber. Hence, it is not used. Another, the pyroelectric photon absorption detector that absorbs the photon energy and changes the temperature by varying the dielectric material. It converts the light radiation into its electric signal. But its response is flat and its speed is limited. So, hence it is also not used. Most suitably used photo detectors are photodiode or phototransistor. Both of these devices have small size, better sensitivity, suitable materials are used, fast response time, speed is better, adequate bandwidth, and most of the aspects are the geometrical and dimensional characteristics are well going to match with the optical fiber, and also they have high resistivity for temperature variation and they have long life. So because of all these necessary properties associated with the phototransistor and photodiodes, they can be used as a suitable photo detectors. Dear students, the photodiode and phototransistors are used in fiber optic communication because they have a small size, they use suitable material, they have high sensitivity and fast response time. Especially, pin photodiode and avalanche photodiodes are most commonly used detector at the output of optical fiber in the receiver, which intercept the optical signal coming from the optical fiber, senses its luminous power falling on it and convert that optical power into its corresponding varying electric current. As optical signal is very weak, these detectors have better sensitivity, better response time, minimum noise addition, fast response speed, sufficient bandwidth, compatible with the dimensions of optical fiber, and irresistive to temperature variation, and they have a long life. So that's why pin photodiode and avalanche photodiodes are most widely used as a photo detector in the optical fiber. Dear students, let us proceed with one of the such a photo detector that is known as pin photodiode. It is a photodiode. Photo means light radiations. Diode means that possesses the PN junction. It operates when light radiations are allowed to be incident on it. It is used to convert light radiation into its corresponding electrical signal, having the PN junction. But this is a special type of the diode in which in between P region and N region, there is an I. That I is called as a lightly doped intrinsic semiconducting layer. Dear students, we know the types of semiconductors. One is intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. P and N are the types of extrinsic semiconductor, whereas I represents the intrinsic semiconductor. What is its special property? Intrinsic semiconductor has a special property that they doesn't conduct at absolute 0 degree Kelvin, but they conduct at room temperature. That is its speciality, but it is lightly doped. It is lightly doped. And a pin photodiode or any photodiode is always used in reverse bias condition. Because in general, if reverse bias condition is applied for the PN junction diode, it possesses large deflection width. Hence, the recombination of electron and holes injected in this particular region due to incident light radiation, it is more. That's why photodiode is always reverse biased. Thus, we can say pin photodiode is a detector that is used in optical fiber communication. It consists of P and N region separated with lightly doped intrinsic I region. Intrinsic I region in normal condition at high reverse voltage, when reverse voltage is applied. But in normal condition means without incident of light radiation. That is a normal condition. eye region has a fully depleted charge carriers. Means we are aware that when p-n junction diode is reverse biased, the charge carriers will start moving away from the junction and they will travel towards respectively in p and n regions. So that's how we can say they have a fully depleted carriers. That is, intrinsic n and p carrier concentrations are negligible than that of impurity concentrations. But under reverse bias condition, when light radiations containing the photon particles having the energy greater than or equal to the band gap energy, photon gives energy to excite free electron hole pair known as the photocarrier. Photodiode is designed to generate photocarrier only in the depletion region where the incident light is absorbed. High reverse bias voltage causes carrier to separate to give current through external circuit with electron for one pair known as the photocurrent. Dear students, same is described in these particular two diagrams. Friends, this is the structure of PIN photodiode. This is the P region. We are well aware that P region contains the majority charge carriers as the holes, minority charge carriers as the electrons. Here is the N region that contains the majority charge carriers as the electrons and minority charge carriers as the holes. Actually, it has only one P-N junction. But in between P region and N region, there is an intrinsic semiconductor which is lightly doped. Doping concentration is less. With this particular structure, that's why it is called as a PIN, that is a pin, and it is a photodiode which is operating out the incident light radiations. In normal condition, means when no light radiations are allowed to be incident, when no photons are allowed to incident, and if it is the reverse biased, means this is the battery which is connected, negative terminal is connected to the P region, positive terminal is connected to the N region, so that it is a reverse biased. And any diode, if it is reverse biased, the charge carriers from P region, that is the holes, will travel away from the junction, and electrons from the N region will also travel away from the junction, which will increase the width of depletion layer. Hence, more space is going to be gets provided for the photocarriers to generate the electron and hole pair. But in this case, current conducted will be less. Here, RL is going to act as a load resistance. This is the normal operation of photodiode or simple p-n junction diode in reverse bias condition that doesn't conduct the current ideally. But now if light radiation in the form of photon particles having energy h nu is allowed to incident into the intrinsic semiconducting layer between p region and n region, it will generate electron and hole pair. This is the pair which is represented. If the generated electron and hole pair will be excited or pulled, hole will be pulled towards the negative terminal of the battery and electron will be pulled towards the positive terminal of the battery. In short, we can say the electron and hole which are generated now in the intrinsic region are called as photocarriers. These photocarriers are dragged so as to constitute more electric current through the load. If the light intensity incident is more and more electron and hole pairs, that is photocarriers, are going to be get generated. And these generated carriers will be dragged over to the respective terminals of the battery to constitute the current through the load which we have connected across that particular diode. Thus, the incident photon energy generates the photocarriers. These photocarriers are dragged to the respective terminals in reverse bias condition of the pin photodiode and convert incident light into its corresponding electrical signal. Same is represented in the energy band diagram. Dear students, try to remember. So this is the energy band gap. Easy, it is represented. This is the P region, whereas this one is the N region. And this is the intrinsic I region. That is in the depolarization region. Here is the light radiation which is allowed to be incident in the depolarized region. Provided h nu is the photon energy greater than that of its band gap energy. Easy. Then electron and hole pairs are generated in the depolarization region. Being pin photodiode is reverse biased. Here it is represented as a photo generated hole, whereas this one is represented as a photo generated electron. So this is called as photocarriers generated due to the incident light radiations. This photo generated electron will move towards the N region and hole will move towards the P region by dragging the reverse bias supply, constituting the current, and thus light intensity, light radiations will be converted into its corresponding electrical signal by means of a pin photodiode. Dear students, let ln be the distance traveled by the electrons, that is the diffusion length of electron. Lp be the distance traveled by the hole, that is the diffusion length of hole. Some of the electron hole pair will recombine and may going to disappear. The time taken for electron or hole to recombine is known as carrier lifetime, that is a Tn for lifetime of electron, Tp is the lifetime of hole respectively. And by using the lifetime and that of the diffusion length is going to be represented as ln is equal to square root of dn tn. Dn is diffusion coefficient of electron. And Lp is equal to square root of dp tp. Dp is a diffusion coefficient of hole. Tp is lifetime period of hole. Lp is diffusion length of hole. Due to this diffusion length, lifetime period and diffusion coefficient, power detected by means of a pin photodiode is given as P is equal to P0 into bracket 1 minus e raised to lambda alpha, where alpha is the absorption coefficient, lambda is the wavelength of the light radiation, P0 is incident power and P is the total power absorbed. Same power is represented in the form of bandwidth, that is PW, W represents the width, is equal to PO into bracket 1 minus e raised to minus alpha into W, that is omega. Again, P0 is the initial power, P is the total power, alpha is the absorption coefficient and omega is the width associated. The quantum efficiency and speed of motion of charge carriers depends upon band gap, operating wavelength and doping concentration in N and P region. What do you mean by quantum efficiency? Quantum efficiency is nothing but it is the ratio of number of electron hole pair generated to the incident light energy h nu. Ratio photocarriers generated upon number of photon particles incident will represents the quantum efficiency. It is given as eta is equal to number of electron hole pair generated to the number of incident photons. generally, if 100 photons are incident, they are going to generate 35 to 95 electron and hole pairs. Means quantum efficiency is 0.35%. 35 upon 100 or 95 upon 100. High quantum efficiency can be achieved with a thick depletion layer. If we made a depletion layer thick, then quantum efficiency may going to increase. Dear students, by this particular way, one can use pin photodiode by knowing its working, by knowing its construction, how it converts the optical radiation into its corresponding electrical signal as a detector, as far as the optical fiber is being considered. So this is one of the photo detectors that we have covered today. Next time we are going to study another type of photo detector, and that is known as avalanche photo diode. That's all about today's lecture. Next time we'll go for next detector.